please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Welcome back. Well, straight on to some big earnings then. Reliance Industries was in focus on Friday, up around 2%, but came out with an inline set of fourth quarter numbers post-markets. Now, while the petchem business of the company showed a bit of improvement, the telecom business as well as the refinery business has numbers below expectations. Sonia is here to decode the numbers for us. Sonia, good morning. Take it away.
Hi, Anisha. Thanks a lot for that. As you mentioned, the numbers were in line with street estimates. There were actually more disappointments than positives. If you look at most of the businesses, the petchem business was fine. It was quite robust. But on the flip side, you had the refining business and the telecom business that were a bit under pressure and were below street estimates. And given the way the stock has run up over the last many weeks, I expect perhaps there could be a negative tick this morning. But just to give you the numbers, the consolidated revenues went up by 17-odd%. The EBITDA was up by about 5-odd%. The refining business, as I said, was a bit of a disappointment this time around because of weaker light distillate cracks. So the gross refining margins came in at $11 per barrel versus an expectation of $11.4 per barrel. Even if you look at the trend, this is the lowest gross refining margin that we've seen since Q3 of FY17 when the company had reported a $10.8 a barrel level. The petchem business, though, continues to grow quite well. So the petchem revenues have gone up by 13%. The EBIT is up by about 12-odd%. And since we're talking about positives, the retail business, although it's a very small portion of the overall business, the EBIT for retail went up almost 80% this time around. Revenues were up 30%. So that wing is growing really well, Reliance Retail. The telecom business, however, was below expectations. That's because there was a lot of pressure on the average revenue per user on account of the cut in tariffs that the company had undertaken. So this time around, the ARPUs went down by 11% quarter on quarter, coming in at 137.1 rupees. Subscribers, though, have risen, so that sort of offset the pressure there. Subscribers went up by 16.5%, but because of the pressure from the ARPUs, the margins for the telecom business have actually gone down to 37.8% versus 38.2% on a quarter-on-quarter basis. So overall, you'd have to say inline set of numbers, but more negatives than positives in the verticals for Reliance Industries.
All right, Sonia, and as you speak about Reliance, the standard disclaimer, of course, on your screen, it is the company, the promoter of the company, which owns Network 18, which controls CNBC TV 18. Sonia, and in fact, before we go back to Sonia for CET, let's also hear out what the CFO of Reliance Industries, Alok Agarwal, had to say about Jio's performance in the fourth quarter.
Jio is India's largest wireless data subscriber network. We added more subscribers than all the other operators in India during the past year. We also carry 81% of all 4G data in the country. Another metric of looking at customer and subscriber engagement with us is in terms of voice. On average, our subscribers spend 716 minutes per month using voice.
Okay, moving on from Reliance, but talking about a lot more earnings that are lined up for the day. Sonia, tell us what to expect from SEAT. Can we see a double-digit top-line growth?
Yes, we can. In fact, it's been a good quarter for these tire companies. One, the top-line growth has been quite good because there's been good amount of demand. Replacement demand has picked up. The OEM demand was quite strong. As we know, a lot of the truck makers have reported record high sales and companies like SEAT have an exposure to that. So on the top-line, things have been good. Even on the margin front, things have improved. Rubber prices have been on a downtrend in this quarter. In fact, in quarter four, rubber prices have gone down by 7% on a sequential basis. From a high of around 131 rupees at the start of the quarter, it went all the way down to 122 odd rupees or so. So that will really aid realizations for SEAT. We're expecting the realizations to rise about 2-odd%. They also undertook some price increases, so that will help them. They started a specialty tire plant and specialty tire margins are much better. So on account of all of that, we're expecting the margins to go to almost 12.5% versus 9% same time last year. Expect a good performance from SEAT this quarter. Back to you.
All right, expect a good performance from SEAT this quarter, but can we say the same about Idea? They reported a big EBITDA beat, but continues to report a loss for the sixth consecutive quarter. Reema, what do you make of Idea results?
Well, I expect the stock to be in the green because, you know, prima facie, there is a big beat at the operational level as well as in the bottom line. So the EBITDA beat has been driven by cost-cutting initiative as well as a couple of, couple of one-offs. So on account of that, the company has reported a loss much lower than what the street was anticipating. Our poll was a loss of 1450 crore. Compared to that, the company has reported a loss of 960 crore. So that is, compared to estimates, the loss is lower by close to about 500 crores. But as you rightly pointed out, it is still the sixth consecutive quarterly loss by the company. The data metrics continue to remain very strong. So volume growth has seen a 43% increase sequentially. The data usage per customer has gone up by 28%. While the company has not officially given out the couple of one-offs which aided the margin beat, Kotak had a chat with the management and they indicated that if I adjust for all the one-offs, at least on an adjusted basis, the margins would be close to what the street was anticipating. A quick run-through of the numbers. Revenues down 5.7%. Margins have improved to 23.6%, which would compare with 18.8%. So as a result of that, the loss is also lower on a quarter-on-quarter basis at 960 crore and 500 crore better than what the street was anticipating. With respect to the individual parameters, the average revenue per user continues to decline for the entire industry. For Idea, it's a fall of about 8% on a quarter-on-quarter basis. Minutes of usage or volume growth, even on voice, are quite strong. So MOU up 13.5%. Voice volume growth has seen a 17% growth, and even the data metrics appear to be quite strong. So beat at the EBITDA level, beat at the bottom line, but if you adjust for the one-offs, the adjusted margins would be in line with market expectations. But considering the big fall in the stock, there is a possibility Idea could see some green in the morning.
Okay, Reema, thank you so much for that. So Idea can see a bit of green given the big EBITDA beat. But staying with the telecom space, CNBC TV18's Priya Sheth caught up with Rajan Bharti Mittal, the Vice Chairman and MD of Bharti Enterprises, from the sidelines of the India Economic Summit and began by asking him about the outlook for the sector going forward.
The indices are fine. The growth is happening. And now with three players left, we believe that the industry will find its level. There are certain regulatory challenges. We have already spoken about it, and certain things are being course-corrected, hopefully. So those issues remain.
What more in terms of regulation that you expect should be amended in favor of the industry at this point in time? There is a lot of significant investment that has gone into the business already.
That's true. You know, one big ticket reform that the industry particularly wants is really the taxes and levies that are being done on the telecom. I mean, this is, if we have to make digital India and we have to create telecoms across, especially now with data-led, the telecom levies are far too heavy on this industry. If you really see the whole taxation, including the service tax, we are more like 35-38%. So those issues need to be addressed. Industries engaged with the government.
In terms of investment going forward, we understand that while the industry has already, the companies have invested a lot already going forward, do you think the percentage or the amount of investment will perhaps go down going forward?
You know, everybody's investing, especially we are building data-led networks. So that investment happens every year. We've already spoken about it. And every player in the industry is making that.
In terms of player like Jio that's entered the industry just a couple of quarters ago, they've posted a profit this time around. How do you view this in terms of data? Do you think there is some pressure that is likely to sustain on the pricing front?
No, as I said, as we are now, three players are left, industry is consolidated, the indices are looking up as far as the usage is concerned. Going forward, we all believe that industry has to have a sustainable, healthy growth, and that should happen.
Debt is also a big concern for the industry, and specifically talking about Airtel, of course, debt is also high as we speak. What kind of measures are you taking to perhaps bring down the debt overall?
We've already spoken about it. As you saw, that the consolidation of the tower company is in the process now. So we will put measures. We will figure it out as to how we need to manage. We have to manage the debt in a sustainable way, but we also have to manage the growth of the company and the industry particularly.
So how much can debt be brought down, considering that you have put these levers into play?
That is something we will have to come back, because we have to figure out as we go along on the strategy as to what are the pieces that we are wanting to. At a particular time, we will come back on that.
In terms of strategic reduction, in terms of percentage for the towers business, will you look at a strategic partner? Is that something?
Too early, as I said, the process has already started of this merger. Let the merger happen. Then we will come around and see what we need to do. But at this stage, this is what the announcement that has done on the merger between Infratel and Indus will take place.
people keep an eye out on the Asian indices. Remember, the Nikkei as well as the Chinese indices are shut, but we're getting early rates come by from Hang Seng, and that indicates a strong pop. In fact, the Hang Seng is sitting with gains of almost 445, 450 points. And as we speak, even the Korean markets, they've moved to the high point of the day, currently trading with a gain of about 0.5% as against 0.3% that we saw at the start. What does this mean for our own markets? Well, the SGX Nifty should come up for you. At one point, it was up about 16, 17 points, 20 points, and that has swiftly extended to about 30, 31 points, 35 points as we speak. 10,764 is where the SGX Nifty indicates the opening at. So the Asian markets gradually moving higher, but keep an eye out on the fact that the major indices, the Chinese as well as the Japanese indices, are shut. Our markets too, we have a bank holiday. So let's get in an update coming in from the commodity space now, moving away from the equity space. Manisha joins us with all the details. Manisha, morning.
Hi, morning. You know, when we have seen a steady opening for the metals as a space, so 0.25% to 0.5% on the higher side for aluminum and copper right now. For copper, essentially, it is about the Escondida mine conversation, which has ended without an agreement between the employees and the labor there, and that perhaps is adding premium to prices. In case of aluminum, then we have seen buying come back after nearly 10.5% decline in the previous week. This is because all the countries that were exempted from the U.S. tariffs, like Canada, Mexico, European Union, well, that exemption expires on 1st of May. And there is a bit of an uncertainty on what and how will we see exemptions coming in. Will Australia and other countries which have been asking for exemptions will be exempted or not? So there is a bit of an uncertainty now building up yet again when it comes to import tariffs for the couple of metals like aluminum and steel. So ahead of that, you have seen price rise come in for both of them as well. The crude oil prices have seen a bit of a decline come in. Well, the previous week wasn't so good as well. On one side, you have the U.S. rig count, which has continued to gain up. The U.S. production has been on the higher side. But then again, the reason that the prices have been holding strongly, firmly above $70 is because you still have geopolitical uncertainty. There is also strong global demand that we are looking at. And the OPEC compliance, which continues to be above 150% for all of 2018 till now, are major supporting factors. So perhaps yet another week where we will see consolidation coming in for this one.
Okay, Manisha, thank you so much for that. Another week where we might see a bit of consolidation come in for crude. But it's time now for a quick break. Up next, we'll get you a check on the earnings to watch today. We'll on to some key earnings to watch out for today. HDFC will be reporting its Q4 numbers today. Abhishek is here with the street expectations. Abhishek, good morning. Over to you.
Good morning, Anisha. So, you know, the company has actually raised about 13,000 crore of funds in Q4 FY18, so that should aid in providing some cushion to your cost of margins. Now, from this 13,000 crore, 8,500 crore will go into participation of HDFC Bank QIP. As of now, that has not been done, so that should aid in your balance sheet's cost of fund. Net interest margin about 3.75% will be positive. Last quarter it was a 3.86%. AUM growth has been on an upward trajectory from 15% to 18.5%, so anything above 18% will be positive. Asset quality has largely remained stable, so gross NPA below 1.2% will be positive. And also watch out for management commentary, if any, on the inorganic move or opportunities that they are seeing, either in health insurance or the HFC space. Our poll suggests an NII growth of close to 5%, while net profit to grow at 25.5%.
All right, Abhishek, that's HDFC Limited. Also tell us what is expected from Kotak Mahindra Bank, and apart from numbers, any other announcement likely?
No other announcement, Mangalam. Sorry to, you know, disappoint you. Street is anticipating the highest NII growth, that is at 17% on a YOY basis. Net interest margin, which fell a bit tad low to 4.2%, anything 4.2 to 4.3% will be positive. Now, the loan growth, which has improved from, you know, 13-14% level to about 23% in the previous quarter, anything about 20% will be positive. The low-cost deposit flow should remain strong. The low-cost deposit share last quarter was close to 46.5% for the bank. So gross NPA, it has largely remained stable in the region of 2.4 to 2.6. Anything below 2.5% will be positive. Our poll suggests an NII growth of close to 17%, while net profit to grow at 19%. Back to you.
All right, Abhishek, we'll keep an eye out on that. Thank you so much, HDFC Limited and Kotak Mahindra Bank. But let's take a look at what took place on day one of the May series in the F&O space. On Friday's session, Nifty, remember, closed about 75 points higher, and there was a much higher gain on the Nifty futures, because if you take a look at the premium, that one increased by about 15 points to about 32 points. So that was telling you that, yes, there is buying at higher levels. So there was some aggression shown. Later, we got the data. While the FIIs, they sold about 760 crores in cash market, they actually went ahead and bought 670 crores in index futures, bought about 1100 crores in stock futures. 40% of that was courtesy Axis Bank, and they also sold on a net basis about 145 crores in index options. So let's take it first to the index futures. Out there we saw more buying, protracted buying come by in Nifty Bank, given Axis Bank's up move. So that one added close to around 19% in open interest. The FIIs, they added 12,000 longs as against 3,200 shorts in the index futures, so roughly four longs per shot. And with that, we saw the FII long exposure increase from 54% at the start of the series to 57%. In index options, while there was a net sell figure, remember, there was a lot of buying in index calls, 18,000 long calls added in index options, and 20,000 short puts added. So that means they're playing for a bit of an upside, also protecting on the downside. So put call ratio, of course, increased. So keep an eye out on a couple of these strikes. 11,000 calls saw some position addition, and the 10,600 put also saw some positions being added. Fresh longs were added on Axis Bank, MRF and United Breweries.
Okay, thank you, Mangalam, for that. So that's how the first day of the May series kick started. But that's all the time we have on Power Breakfast. From